Thank you, Dr. Dasher. It's my honor today to stand at Stanford University and to tell you a little bit more about what I have been doing in ITRI. Okay, perhaps you see from the poster outside, the name of the title of my talk, I decided to change a little bit because the slide I prepare, as I sent to Dr. Dasher, I think he says this is too much. Okay, because my material also contains some research in material science and in some equipment design. So I decided to focus on robotic and automation because this is more related to the theme of the course, which is intelligent system. Okay, so this is about the outline of my talk. I will tell you a little bit about ITRI and what we are doing overall research scope and some global collaboration we have been doing and some summary. Okay, now I think some of you already know what ITRI is. Okay, ITRI was founded in 1973. The headquarters is in Hsinchu, which is a city I live in. There are three campuses in Taiwan, one in Hsinchu, one in Nantou, one in Tainan. Okay, and it's a not-for-profit, non-profit organization. Essentially, the research institute is to create economic value through technology R&D. Okay. Our annual operating budget revenue is about $618 million. This is last year, and out of that dollars, we have about 53% from government, and we have to earn the other 47%, the other half, from the industry. Okay. This is a policy set by the president of TSMC. Maybe I think some of you know that Morris Chang, Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Corporation, when Dr. Morris Chang was the president of the ITRI, he decided that the institute cannot always get money from government, from public, or from the taxpayer. You have to earn the other $1, okay? So ever since that, we have to struggle, actually, to transfer our technology to the industry in order to get the other half of the budget. And this is a distribution of degrees of our staff. As you can see, 24% PhD, and we are about 6,000 staff. So you can see that there are a lot of PhD graduates and a master in the ITRI. So it's quite a research force. And most importantly, we cannot do it for profit, okay? Because there are ceilings set by the government that we cannot say we find something which is valuable, but we cannot make money for us. We have to transfer, give out to the industry and let the industry make the money, okay? And there are six core laboratories in ITRI: information communication, electronics and optoelectronics, material, chemical, and nanotechnology, medical, biomedical, mechanical and systems, and green energy and environment. Each one has its specific research areas. And this is the laboratory where I am now in the director position. And the laboratory focuses on robotics, electric vehicle, machine tools, additive manufacturing. Essentially, it's a practice of mechanical engineering knowledge, essentially, and also to explore some new things in this field. Okay, because as you can see that we the ITRI covers almost all the spectrum of the industrial technology today. Okay. Once there are something, for example, if one day flexible display becomes the major trend of the product in industry, then each tree, the headquarter, would decide that the people involved in this flexible display will go out of the laboratory and establish a center. This is called mission-oriented center. And that mission-oriented center, its mission is to spin off, to create new companies, either one or two companies. Okay, then after that, when some people will go out to the startups, and the remaining people will go back to the original laboratory. The purpose is that to separate those people from others so that they can focus on creating the startup. And the government, I think startup, to create new startup is the number one value of ITRI right now, okay? So because once we create a startup, not only we increase the employment, but also we can essentially maybe bring up the supply chain, the whole supply chain of the new product industry. Okay, so that's about the very brief introduction of ITRI. Now I will focus on what we are doing in mechanical and system research. Okay, as I said, largely we can separate, I can separate our research in three fields: advanced manufacturing, which is very broad, machine tools, and the advanced vehicle. Now, why do I have to mention machine tools? Okay, machine tools actually its revenue in the whole industrial area does not occupy a very significant portion. But it's a very important technology because lots of products are manufactured by machine tools. And as you can see that in Japan, in Germany, they view machine tool industry as their most important one. Okay, so we put a lot of effort and the money to study or to research what will be the advanced machine tool. So it covers machine tool design and the machine tool control. And for advanced manufacturing, I said this is a very large area. And currently, we focus on two things. One is robotics and the automation. As you can see that this is because of the trend of aging society, we got less and less working force. Secondly, the wage keep coming up. So to hire a person to in the factory, the cost is getting higher and higher. So automation is an inevitable direction. I mean, so in other words, in the future, there will be more and more robots in the factory. The second one is micro nano fabrication, where in a previous slide I sent to Dr. Desher, I spent a lot of effort in describing that area, which is quite interesting, okay? Things in a very small scale. But I don't have time to do that, so maybe next time I will spend more time on that topic. And the advanced vehicle, actually the trend is on electrification, as you know, in recent years, like a company like Tesla or Japan or American, even American, they are watching the trend of putting motors in the vehicle. It's not necessarily pure full EV, but also hybrid electric vehicle. So we are focusing right now on the powertrain system of the future electric vehicle. There are still some room to improve. And also, this is very, in recent years, Google do the research on their self-driving car. And you see that the Mercedes-Benz and a lot of car companies start going in this area. So in other words, the automotive electronics will undergo a big change, okay, once the autonomous vehicle or self-driving vehicle is on the road. So we are watching how to develop the whole supply chain of that type of vehicles. So that is the two major focus. So I will, in the following talk, I will focus on the robotics and the automation. And specifically, I will talk about three sub-areas within that research. One is cyber-physical systems. I will explain that later. The second one is the human-robot collaboration. And the third one is not related to automation, but it related to biomedical applications. It's exoskeleton for spinal cord injury people. And because they are all related to the robotic technology. Before I get into the details of those research topics, I would like to introduce the lab, robotic lab we have built. Okay, I think most of you have seen the robot, right? Either the biped robot or the manipulators in the industry, in the production line. So either way, you have to have some mechanical design first and integration because it's a small system. Integrating mechanical motors, electronics, software, sensors, everything together, okay? So in order to have a robot that can go into the application field, MSL, the Mechanical and the System Research Laboratory in ITRI, we have built several labs under this robotics lab. There are several labs. We have three labs. One is a robotic system lab. The lab is mainly designing a robot, that's all. Design the robot, okay? Make it work. The second one is a production line design lab. The production line design lab is to design the production line based on robots. Okay, nothing else. We don't use other type of automation systems. We only build the production line based on robot. So you can see that, you can essentially imagine that they are building a robotic cell, the robot with surrounding environment that can do the production. The third one is machine vision lab. Why is that? Because vision will be used a lot in the future because the camera is so cheap. Okay, you can put a lot of cameras with a very little cost. Computing is also very easy to get. So the robot will become intelligent through a lot of vision sensors. So those are three laboratories, sub-laboratories within this robotic group. And it covers all the way from the mechanical design to control hardware and to the system integration. Even when the industry want to buy our robot, they should actually buy our robot. We have to test the robot with reliability. So this is a lab we created for the whole system. And for the robot itself, the research focus is on controllability, which is very classical. Okay, these are very classical control requirement. Accuracy, of course, robot has to be accurate. Speed, some of the robots, they need to be high-speed operation. Usability, reliability, and safety. Okay, I particularly highlight usability and safety because those four are quite classical. I mean, you have a lot of classical methods, even textbook method, and you can, if you practice that well, you can design and make a robot. But in the future, because of the new technology in the sensors and the computing and even algorithms like artificial intelligence, so there will be some new things that happen in usability and the safety of the robot. I will explain that later. And usability, the most important one is the human-robot interface. Okay. Previously, the robot is away from a human in the factory with a fence because it's a safety code. If you put a robot operating in a production line, according to the safety code, you have to put a fence in between that robot and a human. And the fence may have a door. If the human open the door, the robot has to stop. That is the safety code. Otherwise, it will violate the law, okay? But that prevents the human and the robot to work together, okay? Which is very important in the future, okay? And so that brings up the safety issue. I mean, no one wants to go into a robot manipulating area without some safety measures, right? I mean, if the person is hit, then it will be, I think it will be in a lot of trouble. Okay, now, Let me go to the first topic of cyber-physical systems. I will explain the usability and the safety later, okay? Now, to explain the idea of cyber-physical system, I will tell you the need. Why do we need that, okay? The right-hand side picture is a real production line. A lot of robots, and this is a conveyor for a vehicle, okay, vehicle body. So the vehicle body come out from the conveyor, and a lot of robots just, you have seen maybe the video. A lot of robots doing the welding, doing the gluing, grinding, whatever, okay? And the left-hand side looks like a duplication of the real system in cyberspace. Cyberspace meaning they are all in computer, okay? By simulation and by graphics. Now, why people want to spend so much trouble to duplicate the line in the cyberspace? Okay, the reason is, previously, if the production line runs for one model of the car for a year and produce like 100,000 cars, then the engineer or the production line engineer, they may be able to spend 1 month to set up the whole line. Okay, to control the program, every robot, even to program the conveyor so that to make the production smooth. Okay, maybe, 12 months out of 1 month. 1 month out of 12 months, maybe not worth it. But if the car model has to change in 3 months, meaning you only have 3 months window to produce one model of a car, the next three, the production line will switch to another model. So in other words, if that engineer spend 1 month to tune the process, then it's not going to be efficient, right? That's one out of three. Is that one out of 12? Then that is not cost effective. The customer will get higher car value cost. Now, to reduce the tuning process time, this is a way to do that. If we can duplicate the real process in the cyberspace, then before changing the tuning the process, the engineer can go to the cyberspace. This is only in computer. A very complicated simulation. Then he can just adjust everything here to find out if his tuning is okay or not. So if the duplication is authentic or high fidelity, then you can imagine that in tuning in computer will take less time by tuning in real space. Okay? The next question is, if it's successfully tuned in cyberspace, will you get 100% mapping to the real system? That's another issue. In other words, the signal or the control command you fabricate in the cyberspace has to be one-to-one mapping to the real system. Okay? So this is the story I just told. It's not happening yet, but it's everybody's dream in the production line, because this is so good, right? The boss, they say, well, next 3 months I have another model. Then today I can start tuning the model. And while the production line is producing the other model. Okay, so this is, now, the technology to realize this is called cyber-physical system, which is has been in the academic community for many years. Essentially, if you can look at the production line, it's all computer control system. So what is cyber system? It's a holistic view of computer control system under the internet era. All the black characters, they are all, the existing infrastructure for the control. You have physical world, you have structural device, machine, etc. And you have actuators, motors to actuate the machines, and then you have sensor to feedback to some computing hardware, then you have some control software, okay? So if the machine is not hooked up to the internet, okay, hooked up to the network, the machine will work alone. But right now, almost every machine is linking to the internet. So in other words, machine can talk to each other, and machine can share experience. And you have cyber machine, like I said, the cyberspace machine, that can do simulation in the cyberspace. So if we can simulate the real system in the cyberspace and by linking through internet with all the real sensor data and the actuator commands, you can imagine that you can do a lot of things as compared to the traditional one without any internet connection. And by doing so, there are two things that to drive this CBS technology. One is to take advantage of internet and massive computing resource to enhance and constantly improve the performance. That's the one thing. The second one is people are looking at if are there any disruptive technology for individual product technology within the system. Okay? For example, one very good CPS example is that if the tire company has a sensor, which is like a puncture sensor or some gas sensor to detect if the tire is punctured or not. If that sensor has the data sent to the internet, then if I'm the tire company, I would say I'm not selling tire. I'm selling you mobility, right? Because when you have flat tire, then I will know it. Then before you take the phone, I will call you. Say, your rescue will be arrived in 3 minutes. Then I'm selling you mobility. So by hooking up to the internet for everything, you will have some disruptive changes for the business. Okay? Now, maybe the car production line is too big. This is one we have been doing in my lab. Okay, this is a robot holding a pipe, and this pipe is going to a grinding process to grind its surface to smoothly. Now, imagine an engineer, how does he program the robot to do the grinding? Okay, so it's very hard to imagine, right? But if you have a very true duplication of the robot in the cyberspace, then there are a lot of means to program the robot in the cyberspace so that they can easily come up with the commands. Most importantly, if the grinding wheel has a very good simulation of the grinding force to the surface, then that engineer can even perform the grinding in the cyberspace and look at the result. Then if the result is not good, maybe the grinding force is said to be incorrect. So he can even tune the grinding process here to get a correct grinding force instead of doing trial and error here, right? So it will change a lot of things if we have a really good CPS system. Okay? Now, for this type of system, you can imagine you can have a model. I think maybe most of you get an education in engineering, then you can get a model. Right, this is some link. You have some coordinate transformation, mass, whatever. So you can build a model easily. Except the difficult one, maybe the grinding force. Okay, but some of the systems do not have model. For example, this is very typical in factory, where you have a bunch of randomly stacked objects. Then you ask someone to put it in order. It occupies about 20 to 30% jobs in the factory. Okay, so but in the future, it's very difficult to hire a person to order things for 8 hours, and he's get bored. So you ask a robot to do that. But the problem is, how are you going to train the robot? Okay, so the object has a 3D model. You can get a 3D model. And you can tell the robot, say, well, this orientation, then you have a grasp in certain direction, whatever. It's easy. So that has a model. But you don't have model for random stacking because it's random. You don't know how to come up with a model, mathematical model to do that. The second thing is that ambient lighting will affect what you see in the object. For example, this is a shining surface. So if once it's shining, then the camera will get saturated, and the robot will get confused. Okay, so in other words, you have to also simulate different type of lighting situation. Even when a person walk nearby, the shadow of that person will affect the lighting of the surface. So how to get a very good simulation of the clutter background, of the lighting condition, or even the sensor noise? That's That's a very important technology for things without modeling. Okay, so this is someone asked me about how to deal with big data. What is the data mining? It's useful. This is useful, right? Because you don't get model, but you get a bunch number of data. You get a lot of number of data because you can generate the random stacking. There are technology to generate the random stacking. Essentially, it's like animation. So you can use a lot of animation engine to generate random stacking. So you get a huge number of data. Then you can, from that data, you can come up with some algorithms or some data mining or some big data analytics to come up with a rule. Then you build a database. Once you learn how to grab this model, next time, if something very similar to the model, then you learn how to do that. Okay? As you know that there are so many 3D models in the cyberspace. So once we come up with a system, then the robot, right now, they are actually our robot in the factory is learning how to grasp objects 24 hours per day. Because once you give him the model, he will learn and accumulate the database. Okay, this is a technique we use for CBS. Okay. The second topic I'm going to talk about is human-robot collaboration. It's a hybrid, we call hybrid assembly cell. This is one typical application. You can see in this cell, this is a robot, and this is a person. Okay, this is a power core, you know, the extension core. Now, power extension core may contain maybe 10 elements. So you have a cover, you have all sorts of components. If you put together and screw it, fasten the screw, there are 11 screws, okay? By assemble, putting things inside the case, it's not an easy task for a robot. It's not easy. But to put a screw and fasten them, it's very easy for the robot. And it's very boring for a person, right? You just screw it. So in this case, we can put human and the robot together. Human just put things in the cover, and once this is fixed, he just put it here, then the robot will put all the screw in the hole, okay? So this is a very typical human-robot collaboration, because if you want to finish the assembly using the robot, then it's going to cost a lot, because it's not easy to put small things in a very small space. Not right now, okay? So human is good at assembly complexity, but robot is not. However, robot can do repeated things better than human, okay? Because once you tell the robot how much turns, how many turns to screw it, to fasten a screw, the robot will repeat that every time, but not human. The human may miss one time or two, okay? So you just put together these two things, then becomes a very good assembly cell. Okay, so this is what I told in the beginning, that if the robot is not safe, because you see, the human has a robot, and the robot will have some space colliding. This is inevitable, right? Otherwise, it cannot collaborate. So in other words, we have to make sure that within this zone, the human is safe, okay? So there will be a lot of technology to ensure the robot safety, okay? That's one thing. The second thing is, for example, in this case, when the human finish the assemble the cover, he put it here, the most easiest way is to put a button here. Then the person will push the button, then the robot will go down to make fasten a screw, okay? But the more intelligent system is that if there's a camera here, you watch for the human gesture. Then when after the human assemble it, put it here, when the hand leave the workbench, the robot will go fasten the screw directly without human touch the button. Okay, that's very important because sometimes the human just forgot to touch the button. That's a very easy mistake. okay, then you just have something delayed. Okay, so that is a lot of new technologies happening now, and they're very practical, and they require some computer science recognition algorithm to recognize all the hand gestures of human. Okay. In order to ensure the safety of the robot, what we have been doing in ETRI is we think that in the future, because of this, every robot should have skin. Currently, you don't see the robot has a skin, the whole robot covered with skin, that has a sense of touch. Touch is very important, right? I mean, when the robot collides with a human, once if the robot has a very sensitive skin, then he can immediately stop. Okay, so putting a skin on a robot, we think is very important. But the problem is the robot has a 3D surface, curvature. It's like a human. So we have to design a flexible skin to be able to cover the whole robot area. So we have designed a textile sensor array, and it's going to fit a new ISO standard in development, okay? And it has collision sensing, and most importantly, once we have the tactile sensor, once the manufacturer spend the money to put this tactile sensor, not only it has the safety function, but you can use the sensor of touch as a communication interface. Once a person go into the robot, touch the robot, that can mean something. And we are exploring the communication. It's another way of communicating with the robot. Other than voice, other than hand gesture, you can touch. I think human use touch as one of the communication interface. But would that be useful for the robot in the future? That's a question we are trying to answer now. Okay, so combined with this, a very important, very simple teaching robot to do a task is by demonstration. Okay, when a person want to teach another person how to do the job, the most simple way is to do it for one time, then let the person see that. It's called demonstration. Now, robot, we think in the future, maybe this will also happen to human and the robot. And the most easiest way is if you hold the end point of the robot and guide the robot through a motion trajectory. And it's very easy for the robot to record the trajectory and do something else to smooth the trajectory and perform the task. So it's called motion teaching by compliance. What do you mean by compliance? All the links are rigid because the robot has to move fast. But when in the teaching mode, the robot joint has to be loose. So we call compliance. Okay, so we call lead through programming, but it's only for motion teaching. Motion teaching is only a very fundamental one. So how do we research or study some technique that can teach the robot from motion to a more complicated task? This is another topic that is very interesting. So we need some task description and the environment of modeling, because when you only teach a robot trajectory, the robot does not know what's going on. So once you have a model described to the robot, along with the motion trajectory, the robot may have some comprehension of what he's trying to do, okay? And most importantly, if we combine a camera and some tactile sensor, then you will have more information to teach the robot, okay? So that's the second topic of human-robot collaboration. I will just use a simple example to explain. The third one, I think I have time, right?
Yep, you're doing fine.
Okay, thank you. The third one is the exoskeleton, which is not related to industrial application, but I think this is important. This is one of the important technology in my laboratory, okay? It's a biomedical device. And the purpose is to help motion-impaired people. There are three groups, largely speaking. One is joint and muscle degradation. It's a degradation due to aging or directly the mobility, which will lead to chronic and or some heart diseases, okay? this is, I think the aging society, especially in Taiwan, is very serious. Okay, right now in 2012, we people with age 65 plus will be 11%, and it will increase to almost 40% in 2060. So from people getting age, the joint and the muscle will inevitably have some degradation. So it will impair some motion, mobility, capability, the mobile capability. The second one is central nerve system damage, for example, stroke. It's about 30,000 cases per year in Taiwan. Brain tumor, cerebral palsy, even Parkinson's diseases. They all affect the mobility, okay? And these are numbers, okay? The third one is the most serious one, spinal cord injury. It's a complete loss of mobility, okay? The second one, most of people, they only have partial loss. The third one, spinal cord injury, you have complete loss of mobility. This is spinal cord from the neck down, okay? Usually, when people have the damage in the L up, then they are completely paralyzed at the lower limb, okay? It depends on how high the damage is, okay? We have a clinical trial with a patient with a T2. T2 is about chest. So that person is completely paralyzed from the chest down, okay? Now those people, you can imagine that there are quite a number of people, okay? The most amazing fact is that there are about 7 million persons in the world that with spinal cord injury, and the average age is 29 years old. Why? Skiing, motorcycling, car accident, some extreme exercise. So imagine that a person in 20s and he's announced to be paralyzed for his rest of his life. That's very miserable, right? So everybody in that situation, they want to stand up and walk. Okay, so this is a very important technology for human. Now you can see there are some medical studies try to reconnect the spinal cord, or they reconnect the neurons. But it's very difficult, okay? And it's case by cases, very limited success. So before that, a device to help those people, that could be useful, right? So exoskeleton robot is one of the technology to assist those people to regain mobility and prove to be effective in several clinical studies, including in ITRI, okay? So this is a patient. Maybe later on I can show you the video. It's amazing. He is completely paralyzed now. So he can only sit on the wheelchair. And if you want to let him stand up, you need to use two person, because I don't know if you have lift a person without any mobility at the lower limb. I think one person to lift another person is very difficult. You need to have two persons. So the robot has two motors for each leg. And he can stand up by using the motor torque and also sit down by himself, of course with crutches, okay? And this is our first generation, this is our second generation. And this is our clinical trial case. Okay, you can see we covered his eye and we didn't cover his eye. Why? Because he's one of our team member. Because when he sees this technology, he think he wished to devote the rest of his life to develop this technology, because he thinks it's very important. So he become one of our team member. Okay, now he is a doctor, psychology doctor, and he had an accident in year of 29. So he's a bright future, right? A doctor, a psychology doctor. So his case is T2 from the chest down. So he's also helped us a lot. I mean, we learn a lot from those people how to make the robot, okay, to help them. And this is our second generation. And you can see this is the pictures of they stand up. And this is a picture of they sit down. Even stand up and sit down and walk, I think those are very important for them. Okay, so now there are a lot of rooms still to make the exoskeleton more useful in daily life. Okay, what they want is to take this exoskeleton home, not only use in hospital, because in clinical study, okay, when we have some clinical trial with them, doctor is amazing. When they start to walk around, after maybe 1 month, the doctor tests their bone density. The bone density increases. Because when you sit on a wheelchair, you don't have any exercise, your bone will start to deteriorate. And the bone density increase means the kidney is going back in a good function. Okay, so this is very important for them. And I think E-Trees are proud to create this technology, and we try to push into the market to the patients, okay? But I'm a technology guy, so I have to talk a little bit about technology. This is not easy. Why? Because the robot we saw previously is a robot working by its own. It's a robot, right? It's just move things by itself. But this robot, there are two loops. This loop is the human loop. So you wear on a human. Human itself is a controller, right? You have eyes, you have sensors. So you will make decision to affect the robot, to affect the motion. While the robot itself has sensors and also has controllers. So essentially you have two loops, right? The human will make decision, affect the motion. And the robot also wants to make decision, affect the motion. And you have two loops of control, and it gives out the same output, the walking speed, okay? Now, the question is, does the computer has to be smart? Because when the computer makes some action, it changes the behavior, right? But the human is not completely without sense. The human will sense the difference. Then if the person make a counter action, then it will fight with the computer's decision because they are putting together. So in the study, I think the most interesting one for us to find out is that we have to assume that the human controller is very intelligent. It's very intelligent. So in other words, when we observe some signal which is coming out from that human decision, and we think it's within our safety tolerance, our controller simply shut down because we will let the person do the work instead of trying to compensate something. It's some delicate process, and because this is interesting, we call dual loop control. In other words, you have another controller, you don't know what's going on, but you know it's intelligent. It's very difficult to model the human controller, and it's a case by case. So it's a dual loop feedback control with multi-objective optimization, gate pattern generation to keep our center of gravity, because if the person is doing this, then you know it's inefficient. So we have to keep the COG in a straight line, okay? Minimize the upper limb effort. The person has the upper limb, because he will rely on the crutches, right? But so if we don't provide enough support, they will have used a lot of muscle power here, and sometimes they will get hurt, okay? And but in the meantime, we have to save our power because the battery is portable. So in other words, we can not put a large battery there. So there are a lot of objective that we have to fulfill at the same time. So it's called multi-objective optimization, and it's a technique that commonly used in control area. And the second thing is the most difficult one right now for us, is that once we design a controller, maybe this works for one person, but may not work for another, because that person have different control system. So right now we are figuring out how do we extract the common things and separate the difference among people so that we have some adaptability of the controller of the system to different person. Currently, we have to do it with from training. The controller, our controller simply is not intelligent enough to adjust itself to adapt to different person, but it can be done by training, supervised training, okay? The second difficulty is the ground surface condition and slope. Currently, we are able to deal with a flat surface with a little bit slope, that's okay. But if some rough terrain, then it will be difficult with some stones around, but that will be the challenge for our next step. Intention, okay? It's another interesting research we are doing. The person, I mean, it will be too stupid, right? To ask a person to say, walk, stop, no, right? I mean, walk is walk. So when you try to walk, you just walk. So how do I design the user interface for those people so that they can start to walk, stop, okay? One thing is to put a button in the stick here. So we put a button in the stick. But so start to walk, stop, that's easy. But how about walking faster, walking slower? Then you have a more complicated interface. And we are, right now, I think we have successfully do it, is that some of the patient, they can swing their body. Because they are damaging L section, not the T section, so they can swing their body. So once they swing their body, you have the swing speed. So we put some gyroscope system on the stomach, then we test. This is already patented in our technology that we detect the swing speed. And we use that swing speed as an intention signal for the person. So the robot will adjust the walking speed according to the swing speed of the person. Of course, that will also come back, affect the person's swing speed. So we will have some filtering method inside. Otherwise, it will go unstable. Okay. So that is more natural for a person. He just swing. Then he can control the speed. Once it goes straight and stop, the robot will stop. So it's a very natural interface for them. Okay, so that is the. I have finished all my three topics, and I think I will leave more time to the audience. Now, if you have any questions that maybe we can discuss. Okay. The E3. Has more than 20 projects executed across all over the world. Like for example, some explorative research that we have, like in this trip, I went to UC Berkeley and also Stanford. I visited the AI laboratory this morning and the chemistry department this afternoon. And we have our researchers here, and some even have the projects. And in Europe, we collaborate with Cambridge and Sheffield. And Japan, I've been to Japan, I think 6 times this year. Okay, we collaborate with, for example, this year we have a R&D 100 award finalist. One of the work is we done with the Waseda University is the upper limb orthosis. Okay. Maybe I'll spend a little bit time tell you what is upper limb orthosis. Okay, people, we call essential tremor. Parkinson's disease is one of the essential tremor that people have tremor. It's not limited to Parkinson's disease. Now, if a person develops this tremor, then it will be quite difficult for that person to eat, right? Because when you have the spoon, it will be not. So there are people who invent the e-spoon. Have you seen the e-spoon? The spoon, when you hold it, even the person swing the stick, that little cup will stay stable in the space. So it swing the stick, the cup stays stable. So when the person has to drink a soup, the soup won't spill out, okay? That's one solution. But our solution is that we have some robot wear at the arm. Because of the fixation, so the person won't, the tremor will be suppressed easily. But the problem is you just fix the arm. So there are motors here. So once the person, and there are sensors inside, we provide a sensor. So once the person wants to move this way, once he develops this intention, there will be some muscle signal, then we command the motor arm to move. So the person can easily wear the arm and have food without tremor. That's Abraham Ososis. We collaborate with Waseda University, and we are the finalists for this year's R&D 100. And the Research Institute, of course, and a lot of business cooperation, like in this trip, I went to Corning. We have a large project to do with Corning and some other Europe and Japan companies. So we're quite a spectrum of international collaboration. And how do we collaborate with different parties? This is we call open innovation platform. On the left-hand side is we call science-based innovation. So we have people from all the major universities and some national laboratories, okay? And on the right-hand side, these are all companies. They are producing products. They're producing basic technology. And we position ourselves in the middle. In other words, we take the basic research and we try to see if the basic research can meet the production or the product needs. Then we develop all the necessary technology to realize the original research to the product, okay? So this we call, and in the process, we are using the, we call technology building block. For example, if some innovation is related to vehicle, but it's not, they cannot do it just by that technology, you have to combine with other vehicle related technology, then my lab already have several building blocks to combine with those technology and put it into a product. So a lot of institution in the original research, they would like to collaborate with us because it will be easy for them to combine with our existing technology and put it into a product, okay? This is what we call open innovation platform. Okay, so this about, just conclude my talk. I spent about 60 minutes. Okay, I have spent some time explain our E3 and some robotic automation research in MSL, and approach to system viewpoint is a key to bridge the gap between the technology R&D to products. Because you can see in my talk, I always talk about system, not just a specific technology. This is very important. When we talk about the technology R&D, system first, then you know what is the specification. Then you can develop technology. It's not, we are not doing the basic science, fundamental science. We are doing the applied technology. So it's very important. Okay, so we have established various technology platforms. Okay, and we welcome any international collaborations. Okay, I will conclude my talk today. Thank you very much.
That's great, thank you. So before we get into questions, I just want to make a comment about these mission-oriented centers. Those are really well-recognized worldwide as making ITRI one of the most successful organizations around in innovation, in spinning out technologies and getting them into the industrial sector. It's been written up in magazine after magazine about that. I kind of wanted to start out asking you specifically about the exoskeleton.
Okay.
So I know that your PhD is from Berkeley.
Yes.
And I'm curious, your work on the exoskeleton, are you cooperating with Berkeley in this?
No.
No. Okay, no. So it's a separate effort.
It's a separate. The Berkeley has a group. They are
right.
They started by making the military exoskeleton, right?
That
can carry heavy weight.
Yeah, they started with DARPA money.
DARPA money, yeah. Right.
So this is really medical application.
Medical application, completely medical.
Okay. How do you make the decisions about the projects? Because, okay, so here's Berkeley with their exoskeleton. There are a few other places in the world that
yes,
are doing this.
Yes.
How do you pick what direction you will research?
Okay. That's a good question. First, as I explained, the motion impairment. So it's quite a large group of people. Okay. Currently, there are research. There are very few products. I think it's very few. So in other words, it's an unmet market, unsatisfied. The market is, this is an unmet need, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Okay, so once there's a unmet need, there will be some product, the space for product development. So we look at the technology, and we analyze all the technology. We found out that they are not quite mature yet. So we still have the shot. So that's why we decide. We have a market, and it's not mature yet. The production is not mature yet. Then we still have the shot. Okay, besides, it's a humanitarian technology. I think we need to invest.
Okay.
We are not working everything on profit, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes we have to do something good for humans.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
Let's open the floor. Go ahead, Ed.
So I have a question for you on the funding model. If you look locally, a lot of accelerators have adopted a model where they take a small piece of equity in the company in exchange for providing the accelerator services. Okay, so for doing connections, introducing to professionals, helping with business plan review, etc. Have you ever thought of because your charter is never to profit. The profit segment has to go to the private sector, you said
yes.
very early on. Have you ever thought, though, about a funding mechanism that could become a little more self-sustaining than just having to constantly go in for government contracts or business contracts to actually take a piece in equity of the companies that you spin out?
Yes, we already did that. Yes.
And so what can you talk about what kind of guidelines and how much equity you take?
Well, it involves some very detailed planning and rules. Because essentially, when any technology spin out to be a company, they sort of owe something to us. They owe something because we invest on them, right? Either it's money from government or whatever. They owe something from each. So we negotiate with them. So when they make money, they have to pay back us. So then we get a fund. Once we get a fund, we can decide how to spend the fund.
Does Itri have to sell off its stock, though? Or do you, or does Itri
it's
keep
up
stock?
To, it's up to the, for example, up to me.
Okay.
In my hand, I hold. Mm-hmm. Some funds, some stocks of some spin-off companies. So if my decision, of course, it's my group's decision, see if we want to sell some of the stock in exchange of cash to invest something we think is important and we don't want to apply project from the government. Actually, we don't want anybody's money, just our money. Then we decide to do that. It's a decision that we have to think about.
Yeah, okay. I want to ask a little bit more about the kind of process of research. So if you look at the big sweep of robotics technology, it really started out being driven by mechanical engineering functions.
Right.
And the software was really basically very precise control of the systems.
Right.
And as AI has come really into play, I think you're seeing a lot more focus on the software side
yes.
of the research. Can you
right.
comment on that?
Okay. I would say actually, I don't know how to answer the question.
Okay. I kind of set that up without a really good clear question. Are you actively increasing the number of CS people in your lab,
oh, yes.
for example?
Yes.
So as a percentage, that's growing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, because, see, making a hardware is not easy. You have to invest a lot of money, equipment, materials, etc., and but to replace a software is easy. Zero cost, except human knowledge, right?
Yeah.
Just switch a USB disk, you get another software. But to change the shape of the robot, you need a lot of efforts. So once we have a design of the robot, we want to squeeze every drop of its capability by software. Maybe that's the answer from my viewpoint.
Okay.
Then we need a lot of people to write the software for the robot to perform different type of functions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. Let's open the floor again.
Okay.
If you look at smartphone assembly done by companies like Hanhe in China, it seems
you
to
mean
me
Foxconn.
It seems like almost everything is done by hand, right? Is done by humans. And I was really interested when you showed the robot and the human and then the overlapping zone and just what criteria you had to apply to get that to work. Do you see smartphones as being assembled by robots in, say, the next 5 or 10 years? Or
yes. It's actually happening now.
Okay.
Yeah, it's happening now. Except some of the technology is very difficult, but people try to overcome that.
So what company would be, is that like Xiaomi? Is that their advantage over Apple or someone else?
You mean who will provide the technology or?
Yeah, is anyone doing it like right now?
Oh yeah. Almost all the robotic companies are doing it. Like Fanuc, Kuka, Yaskawa, and even the factory itself also study how to use the existing robot to perform the assembly. So that, a lot of activities, but as I said, it's not easy. It's a very difficult task. Right.
So I have kind of a general question about the situation of research in Taiwan.
Okay.
And I remember some years ago, Taiwan was really successful in reversing the brain drain because a lot of really smart young people from Taiwan went overseas and got their PhDs.
Okay.
And they stayed overseas, mm-hmm. right? But then they came back to Taiwan because there were good conditions. It was good to be back in kind of the home country and the home culture. And I was standing on the steps of ITRI, and someone told me that he's worried about the next stage in which the universities in Taiwan would become so good because all these people had come back that people would not be going outside Taiwan anymore.
Yeah, it's happening already.
So you're seeing this.
Yeah.
Is ITRI actively hiring from overseas, though?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I have team members from India, from Europe, even in the United States. But most of them stay in short-term basis, like 3 months, 1 year. We have a lot of visitors.
Yeah.
And maybe unless they marry to a Taiwanese girl or... then we'll say, I don't know. But I think Taiwan is a very good country to stay. I mean, very fun.
And one other question while I'm on the general thing. What about cooperative relationships with the mainland? Are those becoming possible yet?
Yes. Under some city.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There's some area we cannot touch.
Okay.
Yeah. But in general, yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Do you have a lot of visitors from the mainland?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Excellent. Are there any other questions from the audience? Go ahead.
You mentioned power semiconductors. I was wondering specifically in your introductory comments, what areas are you trying to push the technology there?
Power semiconductors.
For motors?
Oh, not power semiconductor, powertrain.
Automotive powertrain.
You mean?
Yeah, it's not, it isn't. It was in your original presentation.
Oh,
yeah.
You mean powertrain? Powertrain system.
There were quite a few slides in the original presentation.
Oh, okay.
Automotive powertrain system.
Okay.
And it said focus on power transistors.
Right. Powertrain meaning motors. I mean, in electric vehicle, even in hybrid vehicle. Okay,
right.
Because engine is a mature technology. Engine, IC engine, internal combustion engine. So we focus on motor design and the transmission system, and also the control system for the electrical system, power system. Yes, that's what we are focusing on.
So out of your lab, have we seen any recent spin-outs, specific companies?
I think we are going to spin out the exoskeleton next year.
Okay.
Yeah, because in order for the patient to take home, we cannot produce it in Itri brand because Itri is not a company.
Uh-huh.
So we are not able to apply FDA approval.
So the eventually, a company will do the clinical trial.
No, we already.
Oh, you're doing. You can
we
do
are
clinical
doing now,
trial, but
and that will be the track record for the company.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And we had two spin out this year, and the one is in plasma technology, plasma.
Mm-hmm.
The other one is in it's essentially a solar generator system, solar power generator from solar power.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a solar panel, but it's a technology that can put all your windows becomes a generator, but still retain the window function. So it's still transparent, but it can generate power. Yeah, that's a second company.
I think we may have to ask you to come back and speak again.
Sure, I can present your company technology. It's very, very, very amazing.
Go ahead. We do have another question.
Expected market size for
exoskeletons,
both domestically and
non. I don't know, because the I don't remember the number of patients people in United States, but overall in the world is 7 million, and every year is increased by 230,000. Every year, you have 230,000 cases per year. New cases.
And also, you know, there's so many variables. Are you talking about the entire walking function? Are you talking about the arm function, for instance? Right? Because that exoskeleton for the arm would also be...
Oh, yeah, yeah, the essential tremor. That's a large, very large population. Yeah.
Essential tremor.
Ben?
In your exoskeleton one, you are using sensors to give it an order to the robotic system. Have you considered use the brainwave, the signal? Why use the mechanical type of sensor? Seems like that's more direct.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's a very good question. Using the BCI, brainwave. Signal, that's, if it's used as a command function, it's still in the research stage. It's not so reliable that can be used as a product. Because once it's used as a product, it has to be reliable. But it is it's a very good research topic. So we are actually collaborating with UCB, Berkeley. Some professors, the professor in WEECS, he's using monkey to do the experiment. So it connects to exoskeleton. And we have a few professors in Taiwan also doing this. But it's an interesting research topic, but cannot be a product because it's not reliable. The person has to wear something here. Yeah, it's
okay.
Inconvenient.
Yeah.
Yeah, and and it has to be powered by battery, so there will be a core, right? Connect your battery. Otherwise, you will have some battery, and if the battery is out of juice, then what will happen? So it's a lot of issues to be considered.
It will be very interesting if we come back and repeat this session, say, 4 or 5 years from now.
Yeah.
I really appreciate your time, and I really appreciate you stopping by on this short trip. Everybody, after this, we've got some refreshments outside. Please stay and meet Dr. Hu and talk with each other. In the meantime, thanks very much again for your time.
Thank you.